times that are super important. And then lastly, if you're not involved in a small group, I greatly wanted to say that's a great opportunity for you to grow, because we do not, as a body, we don't grow in these rows, we grow in circles of small groups. So there are so many opportunities. There's some on Tuesday nights, some on Thursday nights, and then even on Sunday mornings, we have Bible study for you guys to come, and you're already here, so just come an hour early and you're here. Those are some great opportunities. And if you're new with us today, there's this awesome perforated paper that we pay a lot of money for, that you can tear off, and it makes an awesome sound. I like the sound, so that's why I enjoy doing the announcements, because I can hear that sound all the time.
But if you
have prayer requests, or if you're new, you can go ahead and fill it out and put that in that wooden box back there. And now, if you want to stand up and greet someone you haven't greeted yet today.
I have an announcement first.
We have an announcement.
After we get downstairs and have dinner, at the end of that, those of you who are already, like me, already dreaming about vacation Bible school, then we are going to get things started on what folks would love to do if the Lord's already telling you what you're supposed to do. Okay? So that's downstairs after we get on eat.
What she said. So go ahead and greet someone you haven't greeted yet today.
All right, you sir. Oh,
I live in Topeka now. I moved from Kansas City. I moved here and closed my house in Kansas City January 30th. And moved here. Stayed on contract.
Diane and I help in Awana. I help with TNT. She's with Sparky's. And one of the TNT girls that comes, and I don't know if Bill, you pick her up, or John picks her up in the van, but her name is Grace. And Wednesday night, Barry and I were sitting down in the fellowship hall prior to the circle and the opening ceremony there that we do each week. And Grace came up and she looked at me and she says, "I've got a friend of mine and she committed suicide. And her name was Samantha. And I guess she was 12 years old. And Grace had said that she had been bullied. And, just the worst. That's awful. I mean, that's atrocious. But, you know, that's not an uncommon thing. I work for a funeral home, and I hear about that more frequently than you think. And yes, here in Topeka. And yes, even younger than that. And you think about, you know, how would anybody, especially that young, ever get to that people or get to that place where they'd even think that? But it's just the lies that Satan, you know, tells them. And on Wednesday nights during council time, I know last week Bill was leading council time, and we were talking about Satan and how Satan, he walks around as a roaring lion. And Scripture says that he walks around seeking whom he may devour, not who he can joke around with or who he can tease a little bit, but who he can devour, who he can kill. Satan means business. He means permanent. And when I heard that, though, my heart just broke for that family and for the mother and father and siblings, if there were some, you know, just what they must be going through. And it reminded me of a song that Jordan Feliz has out. It's called Beloved. And a little background on that song, his wife was due their first child, and it's a girl. And he was in the doctor's office, and he got to talking to another gentleman who has a daughter. And they got to talking about, yeah, you know, just what are the expectations that the world puts on young ladies now? And that is that you've got to look a certain way, or you're not acceptable. You're not beautiful unless you look a certain way, or you talk a certain way, or you act a certain way. And how that is such a lie of Satan, that, you know, God made each of us the way that he wants us. And so we're going to play this song and just be in prayer for Samantha's family, but also be thinking about, you know, some young ladies and young guys that you know that you can encourage them. Because it is amazing what happens when you encourage somebody who is really struggling, how that helps.
Head full of questions, how can you measure up to deserve affection? So hard. Your heart.
Amen. We are beloved in the beloved. Amen. Let's continue with worship this morning. Again, this is your time to kind of put the week behind you, kind of close your eyes, kind of just focus. And if you want to stand and worship, stand and worship. If you want to sit and worship, whatever. But we just ask that we lift our eyes and our hearts toward God in Jesus' name.
I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire.
just thank you, God, that all we need is you. And as we studied in Sunday school today, God, we can have gold, we can have silver, we can have materialism. But God, that's not what it's all about. It's all about you. If we have you, that's all we need. And I thank you, God, that you are more than enough. I thank you, God, that with you in our lives, that we're more than conquerors, that there's always hope. And I thank you for that, God. Lord, I lift up little Samantha's family right now, God, and I just pray that through this tragedy, God, I pray that somehow, God, that you can draw the lost family members, the lost friends unto you for salvation. I pray comfort, somehow, comfort in your peace over this family. And God, right now, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you will just speak through Pastor Jeremy, God, that you will just fill his mouth with the words that you have for us. God, I pray that we'll put aside the distractions and that we will just meditate and feed upon your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
I did that, not you. So you didn't break it. So I had the privilege of working with some guys yesterday to move a two-bedroom apartment. And you wouldn't think a two-bedroom apartment can be filled with as much stuff as it was filled with. yeah. It was fun. I laughed a lot. We walked up and down this sidewalk and carried a bunch of stuff. Russ broke a few things. I don't think anybody else broke anything.
Wayne,
what did Wayne break?
He broke cabinet.
Okay. On one particular cabinet, Wayne was carrying the cabinet and the door swung open and hit him in the face. And all of the adults that were there laughed. I think Wayne was holding, somebody was holding a dolly on the back of a truck, and that's how we got the dolly over there. We just kind of drug it behind the truck. So see, that was an adult. We didn't let Wayne do that. So apparently not. And then when we got to their apartment is not on the corner. It is like another mile and a half down the sidewalk. But it stopped just before you got to the stairs. There were like five stairs, and everyone's like, at least it's not up those stairs. And I said, but it's right by them. So then Eric will admit this. Eric decided, hey, you can drive over the curb and those parking things that you're not supposed to drive over, and back right up to the door. And so we did that one time. The rest of the time we did not. We thought better of ourselves. That, and then people started saying, you better get that truck out of there. So, let me pray, and then we're going to attempt to dive into this. Father God, we just thank you so much for this time that we can come before you. We pray that you'd be in this place, Lord. I pray that your word would be spoken today. Lord, I pray that we would have ears to hear it. Lord, I pray that you would just have permission to move in our hearts and our minds right now. In Jesus' name, amen. So, just so you're kind of all aware, the last few weeks we've kind of been doing this Why series. And this is week three. There's another one next week that we're going to talk about. And so, to give you kind of an update slash what my week was like, and I'm not going to complain. I'm just going to kind of give you a testimony of the last 2 weeks and why they're so important. Last week, I had something every night. And I'm not saying that to complain. I'm not saying that to go, oh, they're poor pastor. And when you call me Pastor Jeremy, that just, I'm still young enough, that's still kind of weird to me. And so I had something Monday night, we had leadership. Tuesday night, we had Bible study. Wednesday night, we had Awana. Thursday night, we had prayer meeting. And just a plug for prayer meeting, if you missed it, you missed it. In the words of Bill, you feel like Superman coming out of that place. So Thursday night we had prayer. Friday night I had a ball game. And then Saturday I had the joy of working with those six guys to move Vic and Marie. And then we got lunch out of it. And so I had something... That was a whole adventure in and of itself. Apparently, potatoes are not a vegetable. We'll talk more. See you guys. The girl's in the ground. Okay, anyway. So I had something every night. And when you begin to have something every night, what's the first thing that you begin to draw time from?
God. I'm with God.
Absolutely. You begin to cheat your relationship with God. You begin to not read your Bible so much. You begin to not memorize so much. And so the last 2 weeks, 2 weeks ago, we talked about why you need to be joining the church. The reason you need to be joining the local body is because you were never designed to do this thing called life alone. You see, I can sit up here and I can tell you the woes and poor, poor, pitiful me. But because I was able to survive last week is because I have my family in Christ. Because I'm connected to the body of Christ, I was able to make it through every night. And then that leads us to last week. Last week, what did we talk about?
Reading the Bible.
Yay! Somebody listen. We talked about how we need to be reading our Bibles, why you need to be opening up the Word of God and reading it. I'm here to tell you and admit to you that I struggled last week to read my Bible. I would also tell you that things that I preach on are things that I often struggle with, or then after I preach on them, I struggle with them. And so I don't know, most of you aren't preachers, but maybe you know people that have experienced that. And so last week, man, Monday night we had leadership, and I had to walk a lap around the church at like 9 o'clock at night because I did not memorize my two verses that I'm supposed to be memorizing. I would have been really cool if I'd had this week's or next week's two memory verses memorized, and I could have just said, hey, these are my two memory verses, and you got to be like, woo! But I don't have those memorized either. One of them is Hebrews 12:14, I think.
Yep.
Yeah?
Yep, that's the first one.
That's the start, the address. Anyways, so last week I had Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. And you begin to draw yourself away from your time with God. You begin to seclude yourself. And Satan begins to tell you lies. And Satan begins to say, you can't tell this person this, and you can't call out to this person because you're always texting them that you need prayer. You're always texting them that you struggle. Those are lies from the pit of hell itself.
Amen.
You need to be joining the body of Christ. You need to be connected to the local church so you can cry out to people. So you can text people at 9 o'clock at night, Doyle, and say, yes, I need some prayer, or this really doesn't make sense. Or you do need to be reading your Bible because sometimes, hint, hint, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, you go through a desert.
You, sometimes you have weeks in your life or months in your life where it's just so dry, and you begin to go, God, this doesn't make any sense. Why am I in a desert? And sometimes you have to muddle through that. Sometimes you have to get to a point where you're checking it off the list. I know I need to be reading my Bible. I'm really not getting anything out of it, but I need to stay connected, so I have to do it. That's the update for the last 2 weeks. Last week was a difficult week to preach, and last week was tough for some of us to hear because there's just no getting outside of reading your Bibles. This week, you would hope would be something joyful. Well, it is joyful. Something exciting and something you want to hear. Society tells us, though, that what we're going to talk about this week is the toughest thing to preach on. Society says preachers don't preach on this because it's so difficult. It's tithing. And everyone go, okay. So tithing, I added the really, you just want my money? Because some of us will begin to think that way. Some of us will go, well, Jeremy must be preaching on tithing because the church is out of money. Or Jeremy must be preaching on tithing because he wants a raise. Or Jeremy must be preaching on tithing because we apparently don't have any money and we're going to shut the lights off. That is all false. Lives. I talked to the ladies that do the money. We do have money. I did make sure of that. So I don't, you know, I'm not going to sit up here and go, I want your money. I am going to, though, I am going to tell you from Scripture why we need to be tithing. And so maybe you've landed in some of these areas. First of all, tithing is defined, it is an old English word which meant a tenth, which Scripture also uses the word tenth or tithe in places. We understand it, though, as it's an offering to give to God. And specifically, when we hear tithe, our minds automatically go to 10% of our income. My hope and my prayer is that we smash that. That we get rid of this standard thinking that I can come to church on Sundays and I can write a check for 10% of my income, put it in the box in the back, and I am done, box checked, I am good to go. Which leads us to this question, why we tithe. Most of you have probably asked ourselves at some point that. Most of us maybe have struggled with that. Some of you may not even be tithers. Maybe some of us, as we understand that that's just kind of what you're supposed to do. You grew up in the church, and when you got an allowance, that your mom and dad automatically took 10% off of it and separated it and gave it to you on Sunday so you could give. Or you were like me and you sat in the back row with your grandma and your grandpa and they would give you dollar bills and you were kind of excited, but you know that you had to put them in the plate that passed by, and that was still kind of exciting because you got to give their dollar and it wasn't yours. Maybe some of us, we end up with, I got a friend, he doesn't really go to church anywhere, but when he does go to church, he actually puts money into the offering plate because he thinks he's using their electricity, their heating, or their AC, and in his mind, it makes sense, hey, I've used so much of your electricity, there you go, I've paid for it. And some of you may end up with, well, we've got to keep the lights on somehow. You weren't here one day when the lights went out and we actually had to open up the door. That was pretty funny. And maybe some of us end up with, well, that's just how we do church things. And that's just how we carry out the church's mission, is by gathering money in a box in the back or passing a plate around, and that's how we get money to do, quote unquote, church things. In fact, you'd all be correct if you ended up with some of those answers. All those answers are absolutely correct. We need money to do church things. It wasn't free when we flew down to the Dominican last year. We need money if we're expecting to reach the world a little bit. We need money, unless you know of a different way to get electricity for free from a company. I don't. But we have. We need lights on. We need heating and air. We need water. We need some of those things. And so that's how we pay for some of That's how we pay for those things, is with offerings and tithes. And so we end up with why we tithe. But before we answer why we tithe, we need to kind of step back a little bit and go, first of all, what is a tithe or tithing? You'll flip open your Bibles to Leviticus chapter 27, starting in verse 30. We're going to read what is a tithe. Starting in verse 30, it says, "Thus all the tithe of the land, of the seed of the land, or of the fruit of the tree, is the Lord's. It is holy to the Lord. If therefore a man wishes to redeem part of his tithe, he shall add to it one-fifth of it. For every tenth part of herd or flock, whatever passes unto the Lord, the tenth one shall be holy to the Lord. He is not to be concerned whether it is good or bad, nor shall he exchange it, or if he does exchange it, then both it and its substitute shall become holy. It shall become holy to the, it shall not be redeemed." Then verse 34, "These are the commandments which the Lord commanded Moses for the sons of Israel at Mount Sinai." So to give you a quick background of what just happened in Leviticus, the nation of Israel has become a nation of its own. For 450 years they were in captivity. They were told what to do, what to think, how to worship, how to act, what to eat, when to do absolutely everything. And then at the drop of a hat, they're basically a free nation wandering around in the desert. And there's a lot of complaining, and so Moses stops them, and he goes and talks to God about it, and he says, "Hey God, how do you want me to do this?" And God says, "Hey, these are the 10 things I really want you to focus on." We get those 10 commandments. Long story short, Moses gets mad, breaks those original ones, has to rewrite them himself, and they go wandering around. Leviticus, though, the first five books of your Bible are considered the Torah or the book of the law. Leviticus is the law, which is why it's so boring and difficult to read. I have a book at my work. It's KSA, Kansas something. It's all the criminal code and the traffic code. It is boring to read. Absolutely boring to read. Leviticus is difficult to read, but when we understand why Leviticus is there, it's a little bit easier to read. And the reason it's there is this nation, this brand new nation, had never been a nation before. They were just a really big family before they went to Egypt. But they had never been their own nation, and so God begins to give them statutes and ordinances to govern themselves by, how to act, what to do. They'd never had arguments before that they had to figure out themselves. That Moses had never had to be a judge before. And so Leviticus is how to go ahead, how to be a nation on your own. Which is why that verse 34 is so important. "These are the commandments which the Lord commanded Moses for the sons of Israel." And so we get to this question, what is tithing? Originally, it was a commandment that God gave them. They were to give a tenth of everything. Think about that. A tenth of everything. Tithing is the act of giving a tenth to God. What we just read, whether it be grain, fruit, flock, income, it's the portion that we were to set aside for God. It was the portion they were to set aside for the Levites. We're going to see here in just a few minutes. For most of us, we consider tithe as income. Scripture, though, speaks to the idea of everything. Yeah. Not just your income. It doesn't just stop with you coming in on Sundays and writing a check and putting it in the back and go, "Hey, I've given my tithe." Scripture speaks to the idea of everything. If you'll flip open your Bibles to Nehemiah chapter 10, and I'll explain why we're in Nehemiah when I get there. So in Leviticus, this was the first commandment. This was the first time the commandment of tithing was given. Then we fast forward a couple hundred years, we get to Nehemiah, and Nehemiah is reestablishing that commandment, right? Because at this time, Nehemiah is coming back to build Jerusalem and build the wall and build the temple, and he's going to reestablish this commandment. He's going to say, hey, this is so important, we need to be doing it. So Nehemiah chapter 10, starting in verse 35, it says, and that they might bring the first fruits of our ground and the first fruits of all the fruit of every tree to the house of the Lord annually, and bring it to the house of our God, the firstborn of our sons and of our cattle, and the firstborn of our herds and our flocks, as it is written in the law. The priests who are ministering in the house of God, we will also bring the first of our dough, our contributions, the fruit of every tree, the new wine, and the oil to the priests at the chambers of the house of God, and the tithe of our ground to the Levites, for the Levites are they who receive the tithes in all the rural towns. There we get this idea again that tithe is not just our income. Tithe is not just 10% of the cash that you make. Tithe is not 10% of what you bring home in your paycheck. No, tithing is 10% of everything. And I wonder if we begin to think that it would be 10% of our energy, 10% of our skill. Some of you are so skilled, there's a reason they don't have me decorating the church. There's a reason I don't paint the church. There's a reason I don't move people, probably. Some of you are so skilled in those specific areas, that's why you're skilled in those areas. There's a reason I don't work on cars. Chad will tell you. Chad, what's this do? I don't know. Okay, go, Chad. So we get this idea that it's more than just 10% of our income. It's giving, it's the giving of those things to God because it was law. It was a commandment of Christ. And so now that we kind of understand what tithe is, well, then we kind of go, well, what's the purpose of the tithe? I'm glad you asked. Numbers 18:21. Get our Old Testament Bible workout today. To the sons of Levi, behold, I have given all the tithe in Israel for an inheritance in return for their service, which they performed the service of the tent of meeting. And then flip over to Deuteronomy. Told you. Deuteronomy 14:28-29. It says, at the end of the third year, you shall bring out all the tithe of your produce in that year and shall deposit it in your town. The Levite, because he has no portion or inheritance among you, and the alien, the orphan, and the widow who are in your town shall come and eat and be satisfied, in order that the Lord your God may bless you in all the work of your hand, which you do. And so now that we understand the tithe, it is 10% of absolutely everything. Then we get to, well, what is the purpose of the tithe? What do you do with the tithe? We do just, originally it was designed for the Levites, and if you know some of the history, Levi was one of the 12 sons of Jacob. He was supposed to get an inheritance, but he didn't because he was separated from the other 11, and he was to be God's own little group. The whole family was God's people, but the Levites were supposed to be, or were called to be, priests and servants to God directly. And so, in fact, when they go into the promised land, they never got an inheritance. There were cities throughout each of the 12 tribes because some other sons took over and split them up, and so we get the 12. And so within each of the tribes, they were given part of,
not part of. They were given some of the city. They were given houses to dwell in. They were given fields. They were given food. They were given cows. Specifically, then when we get to the new temple, they were given a portion of the offering to God. So when you came in for your yearly sacrifice and you cut up the lamb and you gave some of the lamb, part of that was to go to the Levites, the priests, for their service. It's no different today. Part of your tithe, part of your offering to Maranatha Baptist Fellowship goes to myself, goes to Corey, for our service. Then we go, well, so I'm just paying your salary. That's absolutely not true. You're paying part of my salary. The rest of it, everything I get from the church, I get from the church. But there's other things then we begin to do with that offering. If we went back to Numbers, we get the, we're to be doing the mission of the church. This is exciting. Then we go, what's the mission of the church? The mission of the church is the Great Commission. The mission of the church is to go outside these four walls and tell our friends, family, co-workers, and strangers we meet that Jesus loves them. That Jesus loves them so much that he died on the cross to take away their sins. So they don't have to spend eternity in a very, very real place called hell. That's the mission of the church. The mission of the church is to equip the believers, the body of Christ, to go out and do that. Sometimes that requires money. Sometimes that requires time and energy and skill. If you've ever been to VBS here at Maranatha Baptist Fellowship, you know for a fact it doesn't just happen. You don't just show up on that week and go, it all just happened. No, it takes people time and energy, their creative thinking. They will transform this stage to whatever they need to do. We will transform downstairs to whatever it needs to be. They will make things out of food that you didn't know they could make. They will do things with crafts and you'll go, okay. I think last year they tried to make a lobster and it was early a crab or vice versa.
It was a crab.
Sure, we'll take your word for it. but they will begin to, and it's not just all Joy. Joy will tell you that it's not just her that comes up with VBS. It's the entire body of Christ here at Maranatha when we begin to give 10% of absolutely everything. You see, in the New Testament, the tithe was designed to supply the church, to supply the mission of the church. And specifically in the New Testament, the mission of the church was to reach the widows, the orphans, and the poor people of the community. If we expect, as a church in Topeka, Kansas, to reach the widows, the orphans, and the poor people, the lost people, sometimes that requires funds. Not gonna lie. Sometimes it requires money. That's what your tithe goes for. Sometimes it requires you to do something and to be active. And you need to volunteer. And sometimes it requires your input. Sometimes you go, hey, God's not calling me to that area, so I'm gonna take a step back. But it also requires you to be praying for that. And so do you see where 10% of your income is no longer a tithe? 10%, a tithe now means 10% of everything. So we've answered what is a tithe. We've answered what we do with a tithe. Now we're to how are we to give our tithe. Short and sweet, we are to give joyfully. I promise you, if you attempt to argue with God, it will not end well. I'm willing to bet that most people in this sanctuary today have had a
an experience where they begin to argue with God over their tithe, or an experience where they begin to struggle with their tithe, and it did not end well. Gary Roden will tell you that he did not tithe one time in his entire life. And he can tell you, I think, the date and everything that he chose not to tithe. And it did not go well during that time for him, which is why he got back into tithing. And if you remember from last week, sometimes you have to do what you don't like to do. And eventually, over time, you begin to like it and you begin to do it. One of the joys that we had in Pittsburgh, Kansas, and I'll tell you, we just will tell her not to watch the video. We had a missionary, they were former missionaries, and had come back to Pittsburgh, and Randy and I decided that we wanted to bless them, and so we would put $50 cash in an envelope and send it through the U.S. Postal Service. Everyone's like, it seemed like a good idea at the time. A few months afterwards, we were kind of like, well, I kind of wonder if she's getting it. I mean, she's not really said anything. I worked with her on staff at CrossQuest, and I just never really heard anything. And so Randy and I began to pray. We were faithfully giving the $50 a month in cash. That was the coolest thing. You go get cash and put it in an envelope and write somebody's name on it, put a stamp on it, put it back. You don't know where it's going, but God's called you to do it. And so we were kind of excited, and it was really fun. And so we began to pray, God, just kind of confirm that she's getting it. And so in leadership one night, she began to say, you know, I've been getting these envelopes about once a month with cash, and I don't know who they're from. I think I do, but I don't know who they're from. And so that's just been a real blessing. Then she began to share that she needed to have another ultrasound for their baby. And it was going to cost her $500. And so I went from that staff meeting home, and I said, Randy, we got to go get $500 cash. And she goes, let's not send it in the mail. And so we devised this plan that we were going to put $500 cash in an envelope and put it in her purse. And so we had CrossQuest one night, and we were able to put that money in there, and just to bless her, to give a tithe, because that's what God had called us to do. That was so exciting. So exciting and so joyful it was to give her. The next staff meeting, she showed up and she said, I mean, she was just overjoyed and began to explain how God had blessed them, and she had found this $500, and she knew she had an idea who it could be because it was somebody in the staff meeting that she'd only told that to. And to this day, we've never told her. To this day, I still don't think she knows who it was, so we'll just tell her not to watch this. So you have to keep that secret. Okay. You don't even know who it is, but still you have to keep that secret. So we answer this question, how we are to give, and short and sweet, we are to give joyfully, but Scripture explains it a little bit out of Mark chapter 12, starting in verse 41. And he sat down opposite the treasurer and began observing how the people were putting their money into the treasury. And many rich people were putting in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which amount to a cent. Calling his disciples to him, he said to them, truly I say to you, this poor woman put in more than all the contributors to the treasury. For they all put in out of their surplus, but she, out of her poverty, put in all she owned, all she had to live on. You see, tithing is the 10%, is the minimum that God requires of us. But tithing is more than just writing a check. Tithing is now more than just the energy that you have or the specialized skill that you have. Tithing is to give joyfully to the Lord. You see, we shouldn't come here each Sunday, write our check begrudgingly and go, oh, God, I really can't make ends meet this month. I've got to have this extra. Or God, what if I just work VBS all week and just really hold on to my tithe? I have some bills coming up that I need to pay on. And God, that really doesn't make sense. That won't end. not being mean, and it's not Jeremy saying that. It will not end well. God calls us, commands us, expects us to be tithing. Income is just part of it. The best advice I got was when I began to get a checkbook and I began to get some income. I was about 11 or 12. And my dad would say, the very first check you write should be your tithe. And so still to this day, the very first check I write after I get paid and out I take out of my checkbook is our tithe check. And I fold it up and I put it in the checkbook, and sometimes I forget it and sometimes I don't forget it. And so sometimes I put a whole bunch of checks in there back there at once because I've forgotten them. Or sometimes I put one and so on and so forth. But the very first check we write, the very first thing we take off, is our tithe. And sometimes I still struggle with I don't know, my checkbook doesn't have enough numbers in it. I don't know how this is going to work. But I can tell you, I've looked in my past and I've seen where God has worked. And the best, this is so exciting for me anyways. At the end of this year, I'm going to be so excited to go see Angela and Sandy because they're going to give me my contribution sheet. And I get so excited because I'm like, oh, we gave that much? We gave that much and we didn't even miss it? How exciting. That's just a part of tithing. Income or your 10% money-wise is just a part of your tithing. This brings us back to the last question, is why we tithe. I hope by now you've heard that tithing is not 10% of your income. It is no longer just your income. In fact, tithing, Scripture calls tithing everything. Maybe you're a decorator, maybe you're a painter, maybe you're a mechanic, maybe you're really good with money and you know how to work that system. Maybe you're really good with sound and you know how to do that. Maybe technology is your area of expertise. Maybe singing or piano or kids or adults or teaching. Maybe those are your expertises. God is calling us, commanding us, and expecting us to give 10% of that skill. Sometimes it's more than that. 10% is just the minimum. Sometimes it's 10% of our income, or maybe, dare I say it, more of our income. I hope you begin to understand that tithing is 10% of everything. We're to be serving in the church, we're to be serving the community, and that needs to be our tithe as well. It's my prayer that you've come here today and learned two things. More importantly, I hope you understand why you tithe. I hope now you understand that it's not just a check or it's not just cash in an envelope. I hope you understand that we're to give joyfully to God because God then begins to bless us tenfold, twentyfold. Now, hear me. If you put a $10 bill back there, I'm not saying that God will give you $20 back. I am not saying that. I will say that when you begin to give, and when you begin to give joyfully, God blesses that.
Yes.
God, I promise you, it is a promise out of Scripture that God will bless our givings. The second thing I hope you learn is that when we give, that is a blessing and an offering to Christ Himself.
Right.
We're going to call a musician up here. Maybe you've come here today and God has shown you that you need to begin to tithe. Maybe you've shown up and now you kind of understand you were on the fence about tithing and maybe it was a sporadic thing. Maybe now you understand that God requires it. Maybe you've come here today and tithing wasn't even on your radar and it hit you smack dab in the face. Maybe you've come and now you need to deal with God. Maybe you need to come up and pray with God about tithing, about giving. Maybe it's not even about income. Maybe it's about service to the body of Maranatha. Maybe you've come and you don't know who Jesus Christ is. I would love and I would invite you to come down. The altar will be open if you need prayer. If you would like to sit down and talk to someone about Christ, I would love the opportunity to sit down and talk to you about what he's done, what the scriptures say he's done. I can tell you what he's done in my life. Would you be obedient to what he's calling you to do? Father God, we thank you so much for this time where we can open your word and we can talk about difficult topics. God, I praise you because you give us ears to hear and a heart to listen. God, I pray that we would take these things that we're talking about tithing to heart. I pray that we would remove the 10% of our income idea from tithing and 10% of our entire life to you, Father God. I pray that you would be in this place. I pray that you have permission to work. We thank you so much in Jesus' name.